joining us now for his take on the markets, Japheth Tantianco. Hi, Japheth. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi. Thank you very much for inviting me on your show.
Okay, so Japheth, there's a common notion that when you've got a shallower recession or a shallower contraction, you're going to get a shallower recovery. What about economies like the Philippines? The worst recession in Southeast Asia. Last night, still the worst performing market. Does this superlative set us up for an even sharper bounce when recovery does happen? And I'm going to say when, not if, because we're surely going to recover.
Yep. Yep. Well, with respect to the GDP print, what I can say is that So GDP has what you call an autoregressive character, meaning to say the GDP of today has a say on the GDP tomorrow. So because the GDP that we had in the first quarter, that's where our second quarter GDP will be built upon. So if we don't have much to begin with, then most likely we're going to see another dismal result in the succeeding quarter, unless we have some exogenous factors that can help, that can change the story. Either it can give boost to the economic recovery or it could worsen the recession. So right now, given the GDP print that we have in the first quarter of 2021, of course, we're expecting that it's going to have a negative effect on the GDP of the second quarter. And we do have an additional factor. The second quarter, unfortunately, it's a negative one. That is the resurgence of the COVID-19 cases plus the reimposition of the strict quarantine measures in the national capital region plus. Mm-hmm. So given these, second quarter GDP could be more dismal. In terms of recovery, we're seeing signs of hope because we're seeing progress with respect to our vaccine procurement. That is very much needed right now. If this continues, then of course it will boost consumer and business confidence, which in turn will increase, of course, consumer and business spending. At the same time, we're seeing a decline in cases right now. In fact, if the study by Okta Research Group says that the reproduction rate in the National Capital Region is declining, and this gives us hope that there could be a further reopening or easing of restrictions moving forward. If so, then we're going to see more economic activities, more production. And given that, that's going to be the start of our movement towards recovery.
Given your outlook, Japheth, where do you see this index going then? We've been retesting lower lows. It used to be 63.65. Now we're in 62.63. Mm. So what is the range that you're looking at in the short term at least?
Well, for now, we see a support for the market. An immediate support at the 6,100 level. Meanwhile, the immediate resistance that we see is the market's 10-day exponential moving average, and this is followed by the 6,600 level. Though we did a study, the market has already gone through what you call a death cross, which is a bearish signal. And a death cross signals a possible downtrend moving forward for the market. If you're going to look at the death cross, if you're going to look at the past five death crosses that has appeared in the market prior to this one, from the appearance of the death cross to the market's bottom, the market has declined by an average of about 17.1%. So if you're going to apply that to the current scenario, ooh, the death cross has appeared on the market at the time wherein it is at 6,415. So 6,415 less 17%, that's going to be at 5,320. So if based on our death cross analysis, then the market could go to as low as 5,320.
Japheth, I'm going to stop you right there. You're scaring the viewers. You're scaring the investors.
My apologies.
No. But thank you for doing the math for us, Japheth. So that's one. That's GDP. Another thing that investors are looking at now would be the MSCI rebalancing. Mm. We have an initial list. And if I could just share with our viewers what that list has. Mm. For MSCI Philippine Index Global Standard, there are no additions, but three companies were deleted Aboitiz Power, Mega World, and Pure Gold Price Club. For the MSCI Philippine Index Small Cap, you have four additions: Century Pacific Foods, Mega World, Pure Gold, Robinson's Retail, and Petron was deleted. This is supposed to take effect on May 27th closing. Japheth, how much more can the foreigners sell? They've been selling us.
Yes, as you've mentioned, foreigners have been selling us. In fact, we've already been under net foreign selling for the past 28 days, and that's an average of 674.99 million per day. Given the results of the MSCI rebalancing, this could have a negative impact on the market, given that this is being followed by foreign investors. Mm-hmm. So given the results, then we may see more net foreign selling moving forward. It could extend beyond the 28 days net selling streak that we've been seeing.
Okay, so we're going to have to depend on the locals to hold this market up. Yeah. Jeff, let's very quickly go over some interesting corporate stories. Philippine Airlines, the flag carrier of the Philippines, are working on restructuring plan, but says its operations will not be affected. There have been reports last week that they're trying to deal with creditors before filing for Chapter 11 in the U.S., joining other global carriers, in fact, as airlines take a hit from the pandemic. What do you think of this? This is not the first time that PAL is doing a restructuring. PAL has had its fair share of restructuring plans.
I believe they need that restructuring because to fix their balance sheet issues. If you're going to look at their financials and the past years, total liabilities has been more than 90%. On the average, total liabilities has been more than 90% of its total assets. In fact, in their latest results, which is available, which is in the first 9 months of 2020, total liabilities is even more than 100% of total assets. And at the same time, if you're going to look at their their income statement, their operating income has not been enough, or it's not been sufficient to cover their interest expenses. And of course, if you're going to look at the outlook of the airlines industry, we're still seeing a dismal outlook given that because of the COVID-19 situation. Mm-hmm. So given that we're not expecting much from the operations of PAL, they need to restructure. They need to find other ways in order to to service their debt obligations. Mm-hmm. That's why that restructuring plan is very much needed for them.
Okay, and it's not just PAL. You've got a lot of these listed companies, giants, trying to restructure their financial obligations. Jollibee also planning to issue preferred shares and buy back U.S. dollar bonds. This is part of restructuring their obligations. While Cebu Pacific successfully raised 40.5 billion pesos in three separate fundraising transactions, also to try to address the impact of COVID-19, to try to lengthen the runway. News like this, Japheth, it shouldn't scare investors away, right? This is expected, is it?
Yep. Well, yes, given that we are under challenging times, given that the financials of the companies are being tested, it's good that we're seeing these moves, or we're seeing these steps from our companies, that they're doing restructuring. Doing restructuring means that while they're in challenging times, while they cannot expect much from their operations, they're doing their best in order to survive, so that once they survive, they can start another growth. They can start another growth story, as the economic recovery comes.
Okay. Just very quickly, some corporate earnings that we got late yesterday after trading hours. We just wanted to refresh the memory of our viewers. The Lushutan Group posting a net income of nearly 6.5 billion. That's up about 5%. If you break down the units, you will see that everybody did well except for Eton Properties, which happens to contribute a relatively small percentage, about 2% of total bottom line, down 11%. But really, the tobacco business, which contributes 77% to the bottom line, is up 1%. PNB is up 33%. Tanduay Distillers up 18%. And Asia Brewery also up by 185%. So this is connected to the PAL story. At least the rest of the Lushutan Empire is doing pretty okay. And DMCI Holdings also posting net income of 4.3 billion pesos. That's up by about 590% times seven what it was year on year. They're citing higher construction accomplishments and better coal sales. All the units except for Maynilad did well. DMCI, attractive to you?
Well, with respect to DMCI, yeah, it's something that we can look into, especially given the performance mm-hmm. they've shown in the first quarter of, you know, in the first quarter of 2021. And if you're going to see it, yes, somehow their subsidiaries, their segments are showing good performances, especially the coal segment. So yeah, this is something that we can look into.
Okay, and an interesting foreign story here. China's population still growing, but barely, and it's expected to slow some more based on their once-in-a-decade census released on Tuesday. Basically, they rejected concerns that their population was on its way to decline. China's population hit 1.4 billion in 2020, with average annual growth rate of over the past decade at just 0.5%. You know, authorities are saying we are still growing, but they are acknowledging the challenges of an aging population and low birth rates. With this kind of news, Japheth, are there new opportunities for labor exporters like the Philippines?
Yes, given the news, yeah, we find labor opportunities for the Philippines, but we can go about this in two ways. Number one, we can continue with what you call with the sending laborers out of the country, you know, OFWs. That's one way. Another way that we can do this is if we are to attract foreign investors into the country so that they can set up their firms here, and you know, that's where they can hire our laborers. With respect to the latter, though, if you may, I would like to add that we need some adjustments in with respect to our labor policies. I mean, if you're going to look at it, minimum wage is still one of the highest in the region, and relatively our labor laws or our labor policies are somehow relatively one of the most restrictive. So we need to make adjustments so that more foreign firms will come into the country, and once they come here into the country, they can set up their operations and hire our laborers. If we won't do the labor adjustments, then most likely, yes, we can still take advantage of that, but it's going to be more of, you know, sending our laborers outside of the country.
Okay. Japheth, we've come to the most exciting part of this conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us this morning?
Okay, so with respect to our blind item. Okay, so if you're going to look at it year to date, it's down. It peaked in, it established a peak in January, and since then it's been declining. But the decline, we see this as an opportunity for investors to take it at bargain levels. When I say bargain, if you're going to look at its PE ratio, yesterday it's been trading at 11.33 times. And this is below its 2016 to 2020 average of 14.63 times. And its current PE ratio, it's also lower than that of its main competitor, which is at 13.31 times. Now, if you're going to look at its financials for the first quarter of 2021, it's been good. Service revenues are up, and core income is also up by double digits. Now, the company still continues in terms of expansion, and the risk here is tighter competition ahead. Mm-hmm. Now, as one last clue, for this company, there has been plans with respect to a change in its leadership structure.
Japheth, you just gave the answer away.
I haven't yet.
Okay, only a handful where we actually reported changing of the guard. But Japheth, thank you so much for joining us. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great week ahead.
You're very much welcome, Mimi. Have a great weekend too.